Good morning. Can I welcome everyone to the third meeting in 2016 of the Infrastructure and Capital Investment Committee. Everyone present is reminded to switch off mobile phones as they affect the broadcasting system, but as meeting papers are provided in digital format, you may see members being using tablets during the meeting. Apologies have been received from Alec Johnson, but I have great pleasure in welcoming John Scott, who is attending today as substitute. Agenda item number one is decision on taking business in private. The committee will consider whether to take item five and any future consideration of evidence on its inquiry into the circumstances surrounding the closure of the fourth road bridge in private. Are members agreed? We are agreed. Agenda item two, inquiry into the circumstances surrounding the closure of the fourth road bridge. The committee will take oral evidence on its inquiry into the circumstances surrounding the closure of the fourth road bridge. In this inquiry, which is one of the most significant pieces of work the committee has undertaken this session, the committee aims to be both thorough and robust in its investigations in order to get beneath the surface of the reasons behind the closure. The committee is aware that people in Fife, the Lothians and indeed across Scotland who have been subject to disruption since the closure will be keen to ensure that the appropriate action was taken in the lead-up to and discovery of the issue, and that all necessary precautions have and will be taken to prevent the situation recurring in the future. I now welcome Richard Hornby, Director, Arup, John Russell, Operations Manager, and Mark Arndt, Operating Company Representative, Fourth Bridges Unit Amey, Scott Lees, Head of Network Maintenance, and Wayne Hindshaw, Chief Bridge Engineer at Transport Scotland, and finally Colin Clark, Partner at Fairhurst. Good morning, gentlemen. I would also at this point wish to place my thanks on the record to Transport Scotland and Amey for hosting the committee's visit to the bridge yesterday. We found the trip to be extremely informative and useful in putting our scrutiny into its proper context. I'd now like to invite Scott Lees to make an opening statement on behalf of Transport Scotland and Amey.
Thank you for the opportunity to set out our role in the fourth bridge closure. Transport Scotland welcomes this inquiry and will endeavour to fully explain our understanding of this incident and detail the considerable work undertaken to reopen the fourth road bridge and effect a permanent repair. Our assembled panel today has been fully involved in the response to this incident and providing subsequent advice to Scottish ministers regarding the closure and the proposed repairs. The decision to close the bridge was necessary to maintain public safety and the structural integrity of the bridge. This decision was not taken lightly and was firmly based on expert opinion of our engineers and backed up by our independent experts who are here today. Our full focus remains on repairing the bridge as quickly as possible. However, we welcome the opportunity to clarify some of the points that have been raised in relation to the defect. Following the decision to dissolve FETA and appoint an operating company for both crossings, Amey took over the responsibility of the bridge in June 2015. Amey continued to use the same well-tested FETA procedures to inspect, manage and maintain the bridge, with the same well-experienced staff complemented by Amey's own considerable resources. These procedures followed represent good industry practice and they are undertaken by experienced staff have a thorough knowledge of this bridge. We've ensured that there were no compulsory redundancies as a result of the transfer in order to retain that unique knowledge and experience that had been built up amongst long-serving staff. And this approach was successful, with the vast majority of FETA employees transferring to Amey. Two staff did opt not to leave. They did opt to leave, but not before comprehensive shadowing and handover processes were completed. The bridge manager left several months before the dissolution to join our operating company in the northwest of Scotland, where he still works. And the bridge master left 2 months after to take up a significant post abroad. There have been questions about the level of funding which was provided to maintain the structure since tolls were removed in 2008. The last 6 years of tolls generated an average annual income of around £10.5 million. And since 2008, the Scottish Government has provided funding of nearly £108 million. So year on year, average budgets were similar to those prior to toll removal. And if funding for emergency safety critical work was required, FETA had the opportunity to draw on their own financial reserves or discuss the need with Transport Scotland. And this occurred on, for example, in relation to the repair of the cable band bolts, where additional funds were provided from our own maintenance budgets. FETA's indicative forward capital programme was considered and funding provided to meet their contractual requirements and deliver capital maintenance in a prioritised needs basis. Transport Scotland made grant offers in line with the outcome of discussions with FETA officials, and these were accepted by the FETA board. Moving on to the Truss End Link Assembly project, FETA considered works to this component, this arrangement, since 2006, and over the years, a number of reports have been considered on possible ways to strengthen this area of the bridge. During all of this, no issue with the Truss End Link member or the pin joint was identified. The principal concern related to the tower bracket weld strengths. Although part of the Truss End Link assembly, this was unrelated to the unexpected defect that closed the bridge. By 2009, a preliminary preferred option was identified, which would see the entire Truss End Link assembly replaced at 8 locations, with an estimated cost up to £15 million. However, this concept was at an embryonic stage, and FETA decided to seek to appoint a consultant to design the final solution. This tender opportunity was advertised in May 2010, but withdrawn in March 2011 due to affordability issues. It should be noted that the Truss End Link Assembly Scheme was not dropped from FETA's capital programmes. Since 2011, FETA worked to re-evaluate the problem and develop a more proportionate cost-effective solution to improve the bracket weld strengths. And this construction project commenced in May 2015 at an estimated cost of £430,000. We believe the defect was unforeseen. As always, in managing and maintaining our assets, we will take this opportunity to learn lessons from this incident in an effort to continuously improve. This incident has highlighted exactly how important this crossing is to Scotland's economy and its people. The decision to close the bridge set unprecedented challenges for strategic traffic in the east of Scotland and people living in local communities. We remain grateful for their patience and the support demonstrated and the ongoing patience of the freight industry. In closing, I would like to reassure you that we have exerted every effort to reopen this bridge as quickly as possible and mitigate the impacts of restriction. And every effort has been made now to fully reopen the bridge to HGVs. Strengthening work to the affected northeast section is on programme, and subject to favourable weather and no further defects being found, we will be in a position to reopen the bridge to HGVs by mid-February.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Lees. Can I just pick up on a couple of points that you made in your opening remarks? You said, if I heard you correctly, that funds were provided for maintenance and capital work from your own maintenance budgets. What year was that, and how much are we talking about?
The sum was £2 million. The year, Wayne, can you advise?
2012, 2013, and 2013-2014.
It was spread over two
financial years.
Okay, that's fine, thank you. And the £15 million was for essential maintenance work that you had identified would be necessary across the whole of the bridge, is that right?
No, the £15 million related to the proposed scheme, which I said was at a very early stage, to replace the Truss End Links assembly, the connection assembly. So that was a cost that the FETA had prepared and estimated. It would cost up to £15 million.
Right, and how much of that work has been carried out to date and how much has been spent on that work?
FETA decided not to proceed with that scheme and came up with an alternative solution. That took a number of years for them to prepare. And it has just commenced last year, in May 2015. There was a trial of the strengthening work at the tower, one of the towers. That proved successful, and then it has proceeded to move on to the other towers. So at present, that project has a budget of £430,000. I think Mark Perhaps you could advise where we are with that in terms of spend?
Yeah, as Scott said there, the project was associated with strengthening repair of the bracket at the Northwest Tower. That was undertaken as a trial, which commenced in May 2015. That project was commenced by FETA and transferred to Amey at the beginning of June. Amey saw that trial through to conclusion in June, July this year. Since that time, we took the learning activities from that project and applied them to the other three areas on the tower itself. So that also kicked off in August type time this year on site at the other locations. So at present, we continued with the same work that was progressed by FETA as a trial, and we've implemented that on site now at two of the other locations, with one remaining to do, and that's being taken forward as we speak as planned works.
I'm sure my colleagues will want to get into some of the detail of this later on, but at the point where authority transfers from FETA to Transport Scotland, how much of the planned work had been committed to?
In terms of how much of the planned work for this element was to do with the bracket that supports the truss end links. What was taken forward was one out of the four areas was progressed as a trial. That was commenced by FETA and concluded by Amey in the June period. The learning from that was then taken forward, and all of the work to replace or to strengthen each of those brackets has and is being taken forward as we speak right now.
And that's part of a programme of work that was handed over at mobilisation. So we had FETA's working programme in train, handed over to Amey, and they continue that. And they've adopted the programmes, the longer-term programmes that FETA developed, into their forward projections.
But the decision not to proceed with the £15 million investment, that was one that was taken by FETA, is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. I'll leave it there just now. I think it might be useful to the committee if you could perhaps outline, just for to inform our understanding, what is the frequency of each type of inspection on the fourth road bridge, and perhaps to set out what are the different types of inspections that are undertaken.
Mark, if you could deal that, yeah.
Well, UK traditionally follow what's called a general inspection, which is a visual inspection every 2 years, a principal inspection, which is undertaken at close proximity each element every 6 years, and special inspections that are specific to if there's particular issues associated with elements. The fourth road bridge, however, is a large major structure, as we all know, so it has its own special criteria, which defines its own inspection regime. Now, the inspection regime for the fourth road bridge is set out clearly in the fourth road bridge engineering manual. The fourth road bridge engineering manual goes on to explain the basis and rationale to the inspection frequency and type of every single component on the bridge. And it's based on something called criticality and vulnerability. Now, this is a risk-based approach, which looks at the consequences of failure, likelihood of failure, load path transfer, a suite of options. As I say, it's a risk-based approach. And from that is defined the inspection frequency for every single component on the bridge. Now, the truss itself, which the truss end links form part of, the truss is made up of a diversity of components from posts and bottom cords and truss end links. Now, the components themselves on the truss vary between 6 monthly and 5 yearly, depending upon what the identified criticality and vulnerability was. Now, the post member, which sits between the two truss end links, is inspected on an annual basis. Now, obviously, when you're out there, you're in such close proximity to the post, to the actual truss end links themselves, they're generally inspected at the same time. The truss end links are captured within all of the other truss components, if you like. So that element would have been inspected on an annual basis. Now, what FETA have done, and again, as Scott outlined, the historic practice that we have continued forward with, is that the truss end links since 2001 have been inspected on between a 6 to 12 monthly basis, with the most recent inspection at that area being undertaken on the 19th of May this year. I'd also like to clarify that this is a unique bridge. And it's not, although we send teams out to look at it, we have a huge site presence there, 24/7. There's about 70 to 90 staff there at any one time doing a diversity of maintenance, inspections and routine cyclic activities. So whilst the truss end link themselves are inspected on between a 6 to 12 monthly basis, we generally have people out on most areas of the bridge throughout the year.
Okay, so you just clarify for the benefit of the committee, when was the crack in the truss end link first reported and during what type of inspection?
The crack, I'd like to also clarify, it wasn't a crack that was identified, it was a failed member. The failed member was identified on the 1st of December this year. The type of inspection, it was, again, I'd like to clarify, not a planned inspection. The planned inspection was undertaken in May this year, but as I said, the team that we have regularly are at other areas of the bridge, so this defect was identified during a site visit to the bridge, which involved members of our inspection and engineering team, including my colleague John to my right here.
Okay, so when were previous safety inspections carried out on that defect and what was recorded?
As I said, going back the records that we have available to us in the Forth Bridge database, it was inspected regularly between every 6 and 12 months back to 2001 is the earliest records I have. And at each instance in that database, there was no defects identified.
Okay. Michael, do you have a short supplementary on the specific point?
Yeah, just very briefly. Just interested to understand a wee bit more about what happens during an inspection. Is it a visual inspection, looking for cracks or bends or things that are worn, or are there, are there measurements taken?
What happened? I'll get John to actually chat through the basis of what the inspection involves, because it is very difficult to access. But it is a visual inspection, yes. As a consequence of that, if there were potential defects or something didn't look right identified, the recommendation may be further testing or paint removal or whatever that happened to be. But John, do you mind chatting us through the process?
No, not at all. On, for example, this particular area, we've had two inspectors at the bridge for a number of years. The main inspector for this area is George Elliott, who's got over 20 years' experience. George would have climbed out on the open truss onto the bottom cord, attached with a sala line, walked to the end where the pin comes down and attaches onto the end of the truss end link. And he would have done a visual inspection and obviously a hand inspection as well to see if he could see or feel any cracks or movement that shouldn't be present. Generally speaking, it can be done with mirrors, etc., attached onto the end of wooden poles. We've done that on the main cables as well, which is how we found the problem with the cable band bolts as well, the crack in there. So George would have done that, and his last inspection was, Mark says, on the 19th of May. It's probably the most inaccessible part of the bridge that we've got. You'll see later on through some of the paperwork that the scaffolding, etc., we've had to put in place there, and when the convener, Mr. Stewart, came out yesterday, although there was a lot of scaffolding, you could just about get an idea of how inaccessible it is. Generally speaking, to get to that, you need rope access. So George would go out in bottom cord, inspect that with mirrors, inspect it, feeling through any defects, taking photographs, bringing them back for inspection. We've got 23 inspections of that locus since 2001, and there's been no defects noted on any of those inspections.
And okay, just ask you then, in your professional opinion, mm-hmm. and with the benefit of your experience in hindsight, was there any other reasonable or appropriate assessment, analysis or monitoring that could have been used to predict this defect?
In the current circumstances that we have and the technology we have at Forth Road Bridge, that wouldn't have been able to be foreseen. If you're asking me for an opinion going forward, structural health monitoring that's going on in the new crossing covers an awful lot of the components that are there and feeds into a new system. We at FETA previously, now Amey, have put forward an idea that we should have structural health monitoring on the existing bridge as well, and we're having some of that at the moment, giving us data back so we can judge how these other components are working at the moment. So it's all technology. It's a 51-year-old bridge with a 60-year design, and my opinion would be if we have structural health monitoring on the existing crossing, then that would be the way forward.
I'm a bit confused because you're saying that it'd be possible moving forward to predict this type of defect from happening, but it wasn't possible to do it up until now. Why is that?
We didn't have any structural health monitoring in place, so we had no sensors, etc., on these areas on the existing bridge. We are putting them on now to try and get the data as to how things are working. So my opinion is that if we had had that structural health monitoring in place, then it perhaps may have been picked up. Perhaps.
Okay, thank you for that. Just finally, along with other members, Dave Stewart and Alec Johnson and I attended a technical briefing at the Forth Road Bridge in December. And at that point, we were assured, I think it was in response to a question from Alec Johnson, that the bridge would be reopened to all traffic. Now, that hasn't happened because there's a restriction on access for heavy goods vehicles. Can you just explain why the advice we were given in December was subsequently not fulfilled?
Okay, I'll take that, Scott. Yep. What we did at the ministerial briefing, we've always made it clear that the repair to this broken member is reliant on two major issues. One being weather, which we've managed to work through, and that's a credit to the teams out there. And the other is that there was no further defects identified. Now, what we did was we fully designed a repair solution that's been commonly known as the splint repair, and it's available in various media outlets and the like, to do a repair on that broken member to allow traffic to return to the bridge. That design was fully designed, checked and certified on that basis to allow all traffic to return to the bridge. However, in any design, you need to make assumptions within your design. Now, conservative assumptions were made, and the truss end links that you've probably seen out there have what's pin connections at the bottom. Now, that allows the bridge to cater for wind movement, temperature, traffic. This is a huge structure with almost unstoppable forces, if you like. So the pin caters for that at the end of the bridge deck by swinging back and forward in the fluctuations. Now, if that if that pin were to become seized, that completely changes the articulation of the bridge. Remember, this is an almost unstoppable force, the size of the bridge. If that pin becomes locked and seized, that changes the characteristics of the bridge. So there's no way you could design any member to cater for a fully locked pin. So what the design catered for was a very conservative assumption on the degree of friction in the pin and its ability to rotate. However, when we completed the strengthening repair phase one and jacked the bridge back up, and as John alluded to, installed the structural monitoring devices, we did some controlled load testing to validate the assumptions within the design. The results from that controlled load testing indicated that the pin itself had become completely locked. Again, a scenario that the design couldn't cater for in terms of the phase one repair. And that's why we looked at introducing a very quick phase one repair to get traffic open to all HGVs, caveated by the knowledge that there was an assumption that some rotational accommodation would be accommodated in that pin. However, until we actually did the load test, effected the repair and observed the results, that was not predictable, and that's where we are today.
Okay, Dave?
thank you, Convener. I think at the technical brief you told the members that about 86% of the dead weight of the bridge is to keep the bridge up itself. So obviously you're just leaving the remainder for traffic. And HGVs obviously have a disproportionate effect on the bridge. The other side of the coin is, like many members, I meet with a lot of haulage companies who are very concerned about the current closure. Is there a scenario possible when the bridge opens for HGVs that you might restrict some of the heavier HGVs on the bridge or abnormal loads? And I think if I remember the brief yesterday, that can be up to 150 tonnes, such as moving turbines, that there may be some restrictions within the general field of HGVs.
Well, just on that point, we did have a really successful meeting and briefing last week with the haulage industry, who were really sympathetic and understood the challenges we were working through here, and the challenge in front of us, to be honest. The design that we're looking at taking forward in this stage, it comprises two parts to it. There's an interim temporary works type part, and as soon as that's in place, that will allow HGVs to return to the bridge, and the third part of that is to replace the linkages themselves. But the design solution that we're looking at there will return the bridge to its articulation and load carrying capacity pre-December, which would cater for HGVs and abnormal loads up to the loads we were looking at. And I'll maybe just ask Colin to comment on that, who's leading on the design side.
The stage two design, basically we're going to catch the top cord and hold the structure. And what that will do is relieve the dead load initially from the existing link, and then the load will be shared out between the existing link and the new temporary works, which allows us then to run traffic across the bridge. Once we get to the stage where we're going to replace the link itself, the works that we're putting in the stage two become the temporary works and take the full load, and that's what they're designed to take.
Do you have any further questions, David?
I'll leave it this.
Just finally on HGVs, what is your anticipated timescale for the reopening of the bridge for HGVs? And I'm conscious that there may be a number of scenarios that you're considering. So what's your best case and your worst case?
At the moment, and this is just based on the data that we have to hand, mid-February remains the target to open it to HGVs. We've looked at all of the eight areas where the similar component exists. And if you recall, when you were out there, there was the side spans, as we call them, and the main spans. The side span links we've identified as being non-critical to allow the return of HGVs, which leaves us with four areas of potential concern on the main span. Obviously, there's the one broken link that we are aware of, and we're undertaking the design and construction works right now to affect that, and that has a programme for completion in mid-February this year.
Mid-February, what if you encounter further difficulties? What's the worst case scenario?
The worst case scenario is that all four of these remaining pins are seized. We've confirmed that one area is not seized and is articulating properly, which leaves us three areas of potential concern. Now, looking at working 24/7 as we did throughout December and mobilising all the resources we can, that would take us through to round about mid-March, towards late March, with any caveats on weather and the like, if all three areas were needing to be done. But at this present moment in time, all we know is it's at that one single location.
Okay, thank you. John, did you have a supplementary?
Mr. Lees maintains that the incident was entirely unforeseen, yet it was identified in 2009 as the truss end links needing repaired. And given the failure, the fracture in this member, was that not a foreseeable outcome of the replacement not being carried out when it was first identified as needing to be carried out in 2009?
Start off, and Colin has 20 years experience of this very issue, so he can maybe come in after me to give you a bit more context. I've spoken to a lot of people, I've read numerous reports, I've spoken to the former bridge master about this very issue, and he, for example, he did not think this was foreseen. The problems that were previously identified with the bracket wells strength, so it wasn't the other bits of the bridge. And when, for example, when we had the handover from Feta to Amey, there was none of this was raised as issues or concerns or risk during the mobilisation period. So we took it on face value that the scheme that was in train since 2009, it took a while to come about, which you may draw your own conclusions about whether there was a great deal of risk or concern about it, that from 2009 to 2015, that's quite a period of time. But from what we've seen, the member that failed was never identified as a risk. I don't know if you could add anything to that, Colin.
When we looked at the study, Fetter asked us to carry out the study originally, we identified various elements of the truss end links. Now, This full assembly consists of the end post. The load from the truss goes into the end post of the truss itself, comes down, goes into the pin, then goes up the link members before going into the brackets, which are then connected to the main tower. The areas that we identified at that time under specific assessment loadings that were at risk were the welds and areas of the bracket, plus we had concerns over the ability of the end post to actually carry the load. We had a workshop with Fetter and we reviewed a number of aspects, and from that workshop we developed a conceptual design which was reported in 2009, which was to put a different system, create an alternative load path by connecting to the top cord and removing the end post and the link members from the load path. Subsequent to that, there was various discussions and we were asked to look at which we could then actually address the critical overstress, which were in the welds and one section of the bracket just within the tower. And that is a scheme that's been developed. We have to make alterations internally within the tower to allow us to get access to actually enhance the welds. And that's what's going on.
Can I say thank you? But the words threaten the structural integrity of the bridge were used in various reports between 2009 and 2015 in the failure of this member. And to me, my degree was in civil engineering a very long time ago, but when you hear the words threaten to structural integrity, you run for the high ground. Now, what was the expected mode of failure then that would have been envisaged in 2009 were this work not to be carried out? Because we've obviously had a worst case scenario, and yet it appears that no one anticipated that, except perhaps the engineers who first created this report in 2009 and identified it as such, as threatening the structural integrity of the bridge. And the failure of this pin, the seizing of this pin in place, turned the bridge from a mechanism into a structure which the bridge was obviously not designed to cope with. That must have been envisaged, surely, given the previous Tacoma Narrows failures and things like that are in the background. Surely this must have been looked at.
Well, I should restate that I'm looking at the same reports you're looking at. I'm speaking to people that you will speak to later as well. A lot of these questions require the answer of the former bridge master, because at the end of the day, he was responsible for that structure at that time. But I go back to the advice I've been provided, that they obviously had an idea. It was embryonic. They revised it because at £15 million it was deemed unaffordable. Now, their decision making after that, there was nothing wrong with what they did. They do what a lot of people who manage assets do. They looked at a fresh look at the perceived problem. They challenged themselves to find, is there another way of doing this? And they came up with a solution. I assume from what I've seen and the actions thereafter that the risk was deemed acceptable. Otherwise, they should have flagged it as safety critical work. And as I said in my introduction speech, was if there was anything safety critical, they could have used their own reserves, which they had, or they could have come to Transport Scotland and asked for help. And I haven't been able to find any of that evidence of that. So I deem and consider that the risk was manageable.
Any further questions, John?
No, thank you. Not.
Okay. Can we just be clear then? So your assessment of the evidence is that there was no safety critical work that was postponed or not undertaken because of cost constraints?
They had a programme of work. They the main committed schemes, and I'll give you an example, there was a lot going on at the time, the viaduct bearing replacement, anchorages, main cable investigations. The team considered those the main priorities in terms of risk, and those were funded. But we didn't lose sight of the other work, or FETA didn't lose sight of the other work, that continued. But the main safety critical works were done. And John, as a former...
The main safety critical works were done. Does that mean there are any safety critical works that weren't done?
No, I didn't mean that.
Well, okay, just to be clear, yes. I think we have to have the maximum clarity here to understand what's happened. Claire's been waiting patiently, but if you've got a point...
Why were the words used within the various reports that it threatens the structural integrity, which is as strong language as can be put in any report? Why were those words used then, if, in your view, that wasn't a threat? It was a view of others then?
Yes, yes.
Yes.
But then the person that the report was written for would have considered that and made their own recommendation and to the FETA board on what to do.
So should we be seeking to get evidence from him then?
I think so, yes.
Thank you.
We'll have plenty of opportunity to do that in the course of the inquiry. Claire's been waiting very patiently to ask her question.
I've got a couple of supplementaries, just some evidence so far, and then my own questions, convener, if that's okay. Just I've got to understand this in my own head. The articulation of the pin that was identified after the repair was done, was that as a result of the repair, or was it just that the problem was identified at that point? When are you able to say that the articulation of the pins was last working properly on the bridge?
Okay, the repair in no way influenced the articulation of the pin. The repair would have only aided to benefit that. If you can imagine, it's supported by two truss end link members. One had completely failed, so I guess the pin would have been sitting not quite parallel, so that would have induced additional stresses into the member. The remaining sections, they've all been looked at the north tower only, and that was what John alluded to earlier when he mentioned structural monitoring equipment. We're investing a lot of time and money at the moment in putting in place a structural health monitoring system onto these components themselves, so that we have the confidence when we can open the bridge. And that's why the restriction to the 7.5-ton vehicles is in place just now. So the programme of works for that is that the North Tower is completely functioning now, and we're getting reliable data through on that. So from the North Tower, as I said, the side spans are non-critical. We know about the broken link member, and the other link member on the other carriageway is articulating as well as it should do in terms of the design parameters. The South Tower, the cabling works and the like associated with that are now all in place, and in fact the strain gauge monitoring system is, as we speak, just going live. So what we'll actually probably do around about now is a simulated load test on that to gather information. As I said before, the primary, and somebody alluded to, the 80-odd% of the bridge is its dead load. The other major influence factors on it are wind, temperature and traffic, about a third, a third, a third. Now, it's unfortunate in terms of where we are today. It's not windy and it's very stagnant, so that's probably the biggest influential load on the bridge. The temperature is fairly consistent. And the traffic, obviously, it's got load restrictions on it just now. So that was why we're looking at probably doing a simulated load test as we speak just now, to try and force movement into that under controlled circumstances so that we can ascertain if indeed the other pins are articulating as we hope they are.
Okay. So the problem with the articulation of the pin could have been there before the truss end link.
It could have been, yes.
Right. Okay, that's fine. Thank you for that. And in terms of the £15 million project that was identified by FETA, had they gone ahead with that project, can you give us an estimate of how long the bridge would have been closed had that been done?
We have had a chat about that too. Obviously, we're hypothesising because they hadn't finalised a design. But I think John and I, we had a wee debate about that, and we reckoned it could be done over a number of overnight closures.
Potentially weekends.
So it would probably have been 3 months of overnight weekend closures. Yes.
Okay, thank you. In terms of one area of question is really about the whole decision-making process about closing the bridge. And I just wonder if you could talk us through the timeline. Obviously, it was restricted to single lane on the 1st of December. It then went to the engineering assessment, and it then went to Transport Scotland and to the ministers. And it's just really to talk through that process. Bearing in mind, you've already said that safety and maintaining the integrity of the bridge were the two driving factors in that decision.
Okay, I'll chat you through the timeline and the circumstances surrounding the recommendation to close it. So on the 1st of December, like I said before, we were hosting a site visit with a number of my colleagues out at the bridge. At around about 3:30 on that date, we received a phone call back in the office, and myself and the bridge manager were requested to go and inspect this element because it was identified as failed. We did that, and as we're based at the bridge, that was undertaken within a sort of half an hour period. We then obviously realised the significance of this and the magnitude of the potential disruption we were talking about here. We notified Transport Scotland at the same time, between 3:30 and 4:00 on the 1st. We then quickly engaged Fairhurst, who have a long historic experience not only of the bridge but actually of the truss end link assembly componentry. That happened at 4:00 the same day. We had various telephone conference calls with Scott and his colleagues at Transport Scotland and Fairhurst to take advice on what this means for the bridge. And by 9:30 that night, a contraflow was in place on the southbound carriageway. The reason we put it till 9:30 from the defect identification and kind of a preliminary assessment was that we were heading into the peak rush hour period. A contraflow takes around about 2.5 hours to safely install on the bridge. So that was the fastest time that we could proportionately get it on to take the load traffic off of that affected member. On the same night, the guys worked around the clock, in all fairness. We engaged Arup, who are an independent checker. And again, the prognosis and basis to that was that, if I refer back to the bracket work that we're currently underway in strengthening, Fairhurst were the designer and Arup were the checking party for that, with Amey managing it. So that was the logical team to take this forward. So at 11 o'clock that night, Arup were then engaged in order to work with us and our colleagues to do the check. And we undertook overnight monitoring at the other members we could access. Now, again, it was windy and dark, and that was the safest prognosis in terms of the people undertaking the inspection. That led us to, obviously, the contraflow situation, which led into the 2nd of December. Now, I can keep chatting you through the timeline of how we got to full closure, if you want.
Yes, yeah, please. Yep. Yeah,
so on the 2nd of December, the teams that we had, based on the information, it's fair, you can imagine, quite complex computer models that replicate and simulate the loading effects on the bridge. They updated those models to replicate a broken truss end link within that. That takes a little bit of time, and then you've got the various loading patterns and articulation movements to cater for. That analysis continued throughout the day and indeed overnight. At the same time, our team on the site were mobilised, and they inspected all 8 other areas to make sure that there were no similar defects or broken members elsewhere, which there weren't visually. However, we also felt it prudent to undertake non-destructive testing, and what I mean by that is we physically remove the paint from the affected member in the welds, and we do localised testing, which will give you indications if there's cracks present there or not. So that proceeded throughout the day on the 2nd of December. On the 3rd of December, which was the day it was recommended for closure, again, the teams on the design and the assessment side had been working throughout the night and indeed into that morning. We'd removed the paint and mobilised a non-destructive testing team to come out to site. They visited the site and they did the testing on the single remaining link that was in place at the northeast tower. The results from that became available just after lunchtime, early afternoon, and that identified the potential propagation of a crack in the one remaining link. Now, that changed what the guys had to model in their analysis. That now meant that not just was one of the twin links potentially failed, you had to model both links as failed. And the only real conclusion from that was that the bridge required closure. Now, the timescale for that was, again, various dialogues and meetings, because our offices are there and Transport Scotland were with us, that by 4 o'clock that day, Amey submitted a written recommendation on the background basis and justification why the decision to close the bridge was proportionate, responsible, and had the full support of independent experts. By 6 o'clock that evening, the independent parties had supported that decision and made written recommendation to Transport Scotland and the Scottish ministers. At 8 o'clock in the evening that night, we held an initial senior meeting with Transport Scotland representatives and ourselves prior to a briefing with the First Minister to chat through again the prognosis basis and risk-based approach that this needed to take. It's maybe just one point worth noting that this was not a decision lightly taken by either the engineers, Transport Scotland, or indeed the Scottish ministers. John's who's been at the bridge for 35 years and has been experienced in the cable band bolts, obviously the concerns with the main cables themselves over the years. Before we reached that conclusion, we all went round the room individually and says, how do you feel and are you happy with the recommendation? And it's the most uncomfortable anyone's ever felt in that scenario. It was the most unpleasant or uncomfortable situation John's experienced on the bridge. So this was not a decision that was taken lightly. At 8:30 on the 3rd of December, we held a briefing with the First Minister, the Deputy First Minister, the Cabinet Secretary and the Minister for Transport to abreast him of the situation, which you can imagine there was a bit of shock there at first, but in fairness to all of the Cabinet, they were really balanced and supportive, understood what we were saying, asked appropriate and challenging questions, and by about 9 o'clock that night, a consensus was reached that the bridge should be closed on the grounds of safety and structural integrity to all traffic. That closure came into effect at midnight that night, and that was the closure that was in place throughout December.
Okay, thank you very much. Very comprehensive.
Thank you. Move on. Adam has some questions.
Yes, some of which have been answered already, but if I can speak to the Amey representatives here or ask them to respond. It's unfortunate, isn't it, to say the least, is it not, that within 6 months of you taking over this contract, we have this particular problem. Would you like to comment on that? I'm sure it's one of the areas I think Amey are experienced in is in the maintenance of bridges, but I'm sure do not have any experience in terms of maintaining and strengthening major suspension bridges. So in that context, would you like to answer my question, please?
Okay. I'd maybe counter that. Amey do have significant experience on major structures, primarily in the UK. We led on the Hammersmith closure in London at the 2012 Olympics. We've led on Tinsley Viaduct strengthening and repair. And you're correct that the suspension bridges, we don't have a long past experience. However, if I take you back to when Amey tendered for this contract, we recognise that we've got lots of positives and indeed where we need to enhance that. That was the primary reason that Arup, who are the designer on the Queen's, or the engineer's representative on the Queen's Ferry crossing, were brought in as our partner for this commission. Representatives from Arup attended the competitive dialogue meetings, supported us throughout mobilisation, support us in taking design schemes forward, like I mentioned, the truss end link bracket strengthening works. So they are an integrated part of our team, as are Fairhurst, who have the long history on the bridge, and that's the comprehensive team that we assembled. In terms of, it's not the dream start I would have wanted to the contract, to be honest, and I don't think anybody would. However, I have to say that often the best experiences come out of the worst situations, And I have to pay credit to both the teams in the office and out on site working in December. We had over 300 people that were safety inducted onto that site. No stone was left unturned in terms of scaffolding, welding resource. It was a privilege and an honour to work with the people in those circumstances, and it's all credit due to them. And it was an integrated teamwork approach with Transport Scotland, regular briefings to ministers. So, it's not the situation any of us really wanted at all, but there's been a lot of positives come out of it, and indeed the support of the communities that were affected by it. We've had, I think, best part of 2 million likes or whatever it is on Facebook. We've had people approaching us about how do I change career and get involved in engineering. So there are many positives to come out of it. There's a big negative impact, and we're still working through the challenges of that through the HGV industry. But if you want to add, John.
Just one other little note regarding coming in and having this on your doorstep within the first 6 months. I have worked there 30 years I've seen out 3 general managers, I think it's Bridgemasters now. And if you ask Barry next week what his first few months were like when he took over from Alistair Andrew in 2008, we had a series of incidents within the first week of taking over regarding closures, problems with hires, problems with cables coming loose, a dropped object canopy that lost half of its equipment on the southbound carriageway. It wasn't a great start for Barry and us either at that time. So to be honest, although it's massive and we've closed the bridge down for this, it is just another day at the Forth Road Bridge, unfortunately. It's a 50-year-old bridge, it's a great structure, but you've got to maintain it and keep it going. And it is a bigger one, but it's just another day at the Forth Road Bridge.
If I could just close that out as well, is that you need to remain mindful that 95% of the staff that were delivering the services at the bridge before June and before Amey took over are still there. Mm-hmm. It's the same people doing the same tasks and the same jobs, enhanced by, I guess, a larger team that Amey are able to offer, and the same supporting consultants.
So you didn't have any difficulty in actually putting together the teams, as it were, to design and implement the repair solutions, for example. It was all to hand.
As I said, in the timeline there, from the crack or the failed member being identified in the early afternoon, by 4 o'clock that day, we had our design team ready, and by 11 o'clock that evening, we had the design check team ready. And we enhanced that through the appointment of an Amey technical director who's got more than 30 years as a chartered structural engineer. I would challenge anybody to do anything more than what we did.
Right. Okay. Now, can I go back to Mr. Russell's evidence a little earlier when he talked about installing structural health monitoring? Why wasn't that done when you actually took over operation of the bridge? Why do we have to wait for this incident to happen before that is put in place?
Well, to be honest, all the years I've worked with FETA and previously before in the Forth Road Bridge Joint Board, we didn't install it then either. So it's really not an Amey problem as such. It's a difficult thing to do in the environment that we have. To try and get that information back to what we have at Forth Road Bridge, or what we had at Forth Road Bridge before Amey took over. We had conversations many a time in the senior management team before Amey took over regarding trying to link in with the structural health monitoring that was going in place on the new crossing, and we hope to then get some of that technology put on the bridge. But as Scott and as Wayne have said earlier on, you have to prioritise what you do. We had a capital plan which we called a wish list, and every engineer will tell you that's what they want to do. They want to go over every single thing that's out there and fix everything as if it's brand new. You can't do that. You've got limited scope to do that for access issues and for funding. Even when we had the money coming in from the tolls themselves, we still had a wish list, and it was quite substantial. So we hope we'll be able to continue with the structural health monitoring that we've got at the moment and enhance it going forward and move it on different locations on the bridge where we might think it's useful.
Is it common practice, perhaps Mr. Lees could answer this, for this kind of monitoring be put in place in other bridge structures, perhaps older ones such as the Forth Road Bridge?
This is something that is fairly new to me, but in terms of experience of that very issue, but we've had discussions, and perhaps Richard, you can come in here just to add to this, but certain older bridges have had systems retrofitted as technology has advanced, sometimes due to concerns about they think something's wrong with the bridge and they want to know about it, sometimes it's an age thing, isn't it?
It's an embryonic science, I would say, that it is not it's not common or widespread in its use. It normally is a retrofit that when it's installed, when problems are identified, within broken members or signs of distress are noted in elements, and so rather than repair, you install the monitoring. In this particular incident, the area that failed, it was not identified as overstressed. There was talk of the actual element that was a structural instability that was at the top. If we have a link in a chain, this component has five links in that chain. The element that failed was actually the strongest link. And so the element that was the 400,000 that has been spent to repair the bit that was the structural instability point, that has been affected and is just about to be completed. So it is so that in terms of instrumentation of this, these moving components, I've just replaced the same component on the Humber Bridge, but these moving components have a finite life. And there is a time to replace them, but the actual structural health monitoring of these things hasn't been done widely. It is on the Queensbury Crossing, which is a 21st century bridge with 21st century technology. We have the capability to put that stuff in place so that we're ready for these events in 50 years' time. But that wasn't contemplated in 1964.
But it's available now.
And would be a prudent thing to do on elements that are vulnerable. Yeah. That would almost colour one's criticality and vulnerability assessment to say, okay, rather than having to look at these things on a 6-monthly interval by a visual inspection, we would have something that would be returning data to a computer that avoided someone having to go out to that location.
Yes, I think it was Mr. Russell that indicated how difficult it was to actually inspect this particular element of the bridge, and it was never discussed at board level either during FETA time or subsequently that something like this should be put into place.
The strength of that particular element of the member when assessed by Fairhurst was and checked by another independent consultant was shown to be have adequate capacity, and so that unless it's actually displaying signs of distress, you wouldn't go back there to look at that particular area of it.
Okay, but in general terms, we're not just talking about this particular part of the bridge, but in general terms, introducing this kind of monitoring, was that never ever discussed at board level?
I mean, what I can say is that we have a retrofitted dehumidification system, which is blowing dry air through the cable. I mean, that's why we have the new bridge getting built, is because of the problems we thought we had with the main cable. So that's been retrofitted. We have acoustic monitoring on the cable to listen for breaks, etc. So again, that was retrofitted. A number of these schemes have been taken forward, and it's just a case of prioritising. And Richard's right, if you have something that's not seen as overstressed, then why would you need to do something about it if you're inspecting on a regular regime, which is what was happening?
Could I ask what the cost of installing this?
I can give you order of magnitude cost for the Queensbury Crossing, and it is over. I think it's between 5 and 10 million.
And what about for the foot? What you're doing just now?
So what has been done now, which is, and again, we are. This is I can't comment on the cost of these items, but in some respect, this is a single element that you are looking at to give complete coverage to the bridge on all of the elements that have been identified in a 60-year-old structure that was designed for half this loading. It's a needle in a haystack that you are actually looking at in terms of all of the elements you want to cover. So to give complete coverage of all of the areas, there's a very telling plot that Fairhurst have produced, which identifies the areas that are overstressed would not satisfy current codes of loading, and it colours almost all of the bridge in. So and that is what informs the inspection and vulnerability assessments that go on. But to cover the whole bridge in structural health monitoring would be an enormous task. We are sitting down with Amey at the moment to make recommendations of the crucial elements to say, okay, these are the ones that we, in the light of what has happened, let us make sure that we get coverage of moving parts and elements that would have a significant consequence in the event of failure.
Okay, and have you got a figure you can give us in terms
of the current
the structural health monitoring system presently? I'd be lying if I had it to hand here. What I could do is give it to you after this meeting, if that was acceptable.
Fine. You could write to us, yes.
Okay.
That's helpful, thank you. Any further questions, Adam? In that case, Michael, you have some questions.
Thank you, Convener. I ran a building company for many years and undertook most of our main work, but occasionally did civil work. So I would like to start by complimenting all of you. You know, to undertake that work under stress, under duress, time pressure, in difficult, arduous weather conditions and working conditions generally, I think you've all done an exemplary job. And I'm sure I can speak for the whole of the committee in saying this, and I hope you'll take that back to your teams working on the bridge. And I was, you know, I was quite frankly astonished that you managed to get it open again so quickly. So, you know, I think you're due great credit for that. I'm trying to understand, you know, what's the technicalities of the fall. And I wonder, you know, this pin has seized. And is it the seize that's caused the breakage in the link, or did the breakage cause the seizure? Is the seizure a result of excessive load on that point preventing it from turning through frictional forces, or a distortion there? And also, what kind of event? Is it just metal fatigue that's led to this, or was there a particular event, maybe high wind or whatever, that you're able to identify as the probable cause?
Maybe
you could speak, it's just so that I think it's very, you know, useful to the committee to get a more precise understanding of what's led to this.
I'll give you the overview answer first, and I'll probably hand over to Richard to give you some more of the technical aspects. But first, I really appreciate your positive comments there, and we will feed that back. It is really appreciated, and as I said, it's testament to not myself and others, but the people out on site. As you say, December was exceptionally windy. It wasn't a pleasant working environment for anybody out there. So, but the actual pin itself, as I said, the bridge relies on a degree of rotation in these pins. You never have a perfect pin where there's no friction in it. And you make design assumptions on what the level of friction is. Now, obviously, that pin's level of friction or restraint has increased over time. And within that, those first couple of days, I never actually explained as well, that we also engaged a specialist metallurgist to come out and inspect the failed member itself. And his conclusive recommendation was that it was indeed a fatigue failure. That the reason for that was it propagated or initiated at the weld interface, which is potentially the weak interface, and that could have happened as a little bit of grit or just when the bridge was installed. Nobody really knows what could have initiated that. That then propagated along the weld and progressed into the member itself and give you a very quick failure. And that's the kind of crack or failure pattern you see. You see it beginning And there's a photograph somewhere in the body of slides you've got that you can see that. It begins at the weld, propagates into the member, and you very quickly see a jagged pattern progress up through the member, which is highly reflective of a fatigue crack. But I'll let Richard explain more detail on the coefficient of friction.
I think the so just to put the member in context, so that the link itself, say for permanent loads, it only really carries the weight of the deck between that end of the deck and the first hanger. So that in sort of to revert to the comment about 90% of or 70% of the capacity is dead load and live load, that applies to the cable, because the actual traffic loads that arrive at the link are because of loads that are spread out over almost half of the main span. So it's a much longer loaded length, and they pick up, so the actual variable loads are significantly larger than the permanent ones for this particular element. So that in the normal run of things, you know, an overload type failure, so a particular event type failure with the wrong vehicle going over and that sort of thing, would have had to have been the length of half of the structure, and so it's highly unlikely that it was an overload that was causing it in normal operation. You know, so that if it was some sort of normal operation that was, but when the pin seizes. The bridge tries to move almost under every single vehicle that passes the bridge. So it tries to move backwards and forwards, just a very small amount. And that is why this, why the pins are in position. It is to allow that free movement, because that movement is unstoppable. It has to be seen in the context of trying to hold up a truck that's in the middle between towers that are a kilometre apart, and those are the sort of the dynamics of what you're trying to restrain, and that just won't happen with a member in bending. And so that the loads of that just moving backwards and forwards, if the pin is seized, will just be gradually cycling that the stress, like bending a paperclip backwards and forwards, and eventually it will go. And so that there was, as soon as the pin had seized, there would have been a finite life in terms of the link, and essentially that it will just gradually grow that crack, and in terms of the history of that, although you say okay, it will gradually grow that crack, that needs to be looked at. In the first instances, it will be a very very small crack that would not be detectable in those 6 monthly yearly inspections. It would probably take about that sort of period or a number of months to grow from a crack that's detectable visually to something that has totally failed. You know, that it's the onset of the crack goes from it moves very, very suddenly from that moment forward. It would have been helped in this particular instance insofar that the actual displacements are quite small, and therefore it probably wouldn't have been growing. The actual strains involved associated with developing these loads is actually quite small.
Thank you. That's very, very useful. That's given me a much better understanding. And in terms of the temporary solution, could you talk a wee bit about how it was installed and how it was tested?
It wasn't a temporary solution, was a solution to get the bridge back open. But how that was installed was, again, a lot of effort people probably don't appreciate in terms of, as John alluded to, the access. Access is the biggest challenge out on the bridge, and as John said, that area is probably one of the most inaccessible areas you can get to, because the only thing between you and that member is the River Forth. So what we had to do was obviously provide the workforce with a safe access working platform to begin the work before we actually did it. Now, we came up with two solutions. One involved what's called hanging scaffolding and one called tower scaffolding. Now, again, I think there's a couple of pictures within your packs there of what I mean by that. Hanging scaffolding is, like it says, it hangs off of the bridge. It's faster to install than the tower scaffolding, which you build from the ground up and construct in a tower format. However, we didn't adopt a hanging scaffolding access system at the broken member for the reason there was a risk there that there could have been a potential failure of the one remaining link that was in place, and a quick drop of the bridge deck at that point with people working on scaffolding supported off the bridge was an unacceptable risk. So at that one location we adopted a tower scaffolding. What that meant was that we had to use a barge to actually transport all of the scaffolding materials from landside out to the north pier defences. We had a team that were similarly barged out there every day and every night working on that with lights and everything to actually scaffold up the full height of the tower. And I'm sure the committee members that were out there yesterday got an appreciation of how high up that is. We also undertook an exercise to barge out what's called a mobile elevated working platform. It's essentially a lorry with a big long reach basket on the back of it. You can imagine this is 50 metres up, so it's a huge lorry with a huge extendable reach. That was barged out with a full lifting plan adopted in place to lift that onto the pier defences. And all this went on concurrently with the high winds and the rain and everything that was prevalent throughout December. So that work commenced at that area to provide access to the broken member. At the other seven locations, we also undertook this hanging scaffolding solution, like I say, a bit faster to install because you've not got as much material. And it hangs off the structure and again is a stable platform for the teams to work there. Concurrent with all of that access work going on, the design of the splint or the phase one repair was completed and fabrication took place concurrently with the scaffolding work, which meant that it actually worked in really well with the design check, certification, steel manufacture, fabrication. They arrived on site in tandem with the scaffolding being finished, and that's why we were able to open it so quickly. So again, getting the steel out onto the bridge isn't as simple as just lifting it out. You need a specialist lifting plan, high abs to try and drop it through. And again, you're in a confined area trying to maneuver big bits of steel down through a bridge. It's much, much different than building a new bridge where you have maybe factory conditions for certain components. So again, the team worked hard to safely lower the splints in place. These were then tack welded in place. But again, we had probably more than 40 welders on site working concurrently in all eight areas, as were the scaffolders. That was welded in place. Again, the work progressed day and night with lighting. The teams had to regularly stand down, if you like, because the winds got so high it was unsafe to work. But what that meant is they just got off the scaffolding and waited until the control room indicated that the wind speed had dropped sufficiently to allow them to return. So like I say, that work progressed day and night, and that was why the bridge was opened earlier than we foreseen. And it's just unfortunate that the rotation of the pin wasn't as we hoped, otherwise HGVs would be on it today. And that was a real process we went through.
Thank you. That's been, you know, very useful. And could you talk then a wee bit about the longer term, the more permanent? So, forgive me for using those words, but the final solution then, and you know, have you identified that? And can you explain a bit about, you know, how that was designed and what that will look like, and you know, on the bridge, so to speak?
I'll give you a quick overview again, and I'll maybe hand to Colin, who's the design lead for that part. On slide 7, I think everybody has that one in front of them, there's a graphic visualisation of what phase 2 actually involves. So in simplistic terms, it involves installing a new bracket system above the carriageway at each of the tower locations. The second part of that is we'll install a spreader beam below the top cord, which is on slide 8, and that will support the truss at that location. The final slide is slide 9, and it's cables that will attach the top hanger to the bottom spreader beam, if you like. The team will then jack the bridge up at that location to cater for its dead load, which means that once that's in place, HGVs can return to the bridge because they will be supported on this new arrangement. Having that new arrangement in place will then allow us to install a brand new truss end link assembly that will be designed for maintenance and accessibility. And I guess an important point is through legislation. When this bridge was built back in 1964, people, I guess, designed for best practice at that time, but in the early 90s, legislation around designing for maintenance and accessibility was introduced into the UK. That's had several iterations, with the last iteration just in 2015 there, called the CDM regulations, which means that designers need to take account of access, maintenance and replacement in the future. And that will be in place for the replacement trussing and links. I don't know if you want any more detail from that off, Colin, in terms of...
I think that's probably sufficient for our purposes.
Okay.
And just finally, could you just indicate the... You know, give us some idea of the cost of the work, the splinting work carried out so far, and then the, you know, the cost of the final marks.
Okay, you want that, Scott?
Yeah, I think where we are just now to get up to the phase two solution in the one tower, and all the splints on the all eight and everything else that has been done around this, the cost of that repair will be around £5 million. With respect to the next phase, we're still designing that, so we really can't give you an accurate estimate. But that will come in due course, and I'm happy to share that with the committee as soon as it's defined.
Thank you very much indeed. Thank you, convener.
Thank you, Michael. Mr. Hornby, if I heard you correctly, I think you said that the truss end links have just been replaced at Humber, is that correct?
They're slightly more complicated than these ones, but they've just been replaced, yes.
I was going to ask you, can you explain if it was a similar problem?
It was a similar... The pins had worn a big hole in the... to basically, they started off as a circular hole, and the rotations that we've been talking about had elongated those holes so that there was a cross member that was starting to bear on concrete, and there was fear that these pins would seize up and the thing was replaced.
Are there any lessons from that experience for...
That will certainly go feed through into the, you know, that the repair that we designed for that is now designed for replaceability in the future, and maintainability of these bearings and measures to ensure that these pins are moving. Those lessons will go forward into the final solution so that the lessons learnt in that construction process are implemented in the final solution here.
Okay, thank you for that. I'm going to hand over to John Scott.
And if I might just continue on that vein, when was the need to repair those truss end links on the Humber Bridge identified?
They were identified 5 years ago, four or 5 years ago.
So the ones on the Fourth Road Bridge were identified some years before then. Can I ask you as...
So it was for, but again, I suppose the as I mentioned earlier, in terms of the links of the chain, the elements showing distress on the fourth were the fixed connections into the tower, and the main structural connection within the truss itself, rather than the moving components.
Yes, I'm fascinated by that it's not the weakest link in the chain that has failed, but apparently, so you say, the strongest. But in view, and I would particularly...
Under normal operation, yes.
Well, that in itself poses a question. Mm. Perhaps the evaluation of what was the weaker and the stronger links was inaccurate, given that that was the link that failed.
It would be inaccurate, you know, that one has to base one's assumptions or one's analysis on the inspections that you have. And so that there was no evidence to suggest that those links were, the pins were not moving.
In normal circumstances. But given the wear in the pin that you had seen elsewhere on the Humber Bridge and the need that was identified in 2009, it wouldn't have been unreasonable to... Well, that's the question I particularly want to ask you and Mr. Clark as independent experts. Could this type of failure of truss end link have been anticipated, given the assessed need for a repair in 2009, given, in your words, that the bridge is horribly overstressed with the current loading, and given the age of the bridge? Could this have been anticipated? I understand the wear of pins and rotational circumstances.
In the absence of displayed, you know, the displayed signs of distress, there were no displayed signs of distress in this element. There was assessments were done on in pure. If it has this articulation, areas were identified as overstressed in four potential loading scenarios. So that, you know, accidents on the bridge that cause queues and things like this. So those scenarios had been identified and were the basis of the strengthening works that have been undertaken. There was no evidence to support that, you know, there was no evidence that these pins were not moving from the inspections that had been carried out.
Would you just agree with that?
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely. Fascinating. And can I just take you then to other types of stressing and loading, because purely by coincidence, just over a year ago I was on the deck of the bridge and I was struck by the vibration in below the bridge of the, I presume, the pounding from the traffic on a Saturday afternoon, which is very light, from the expansion joints. And in terms of the wear and the damage to the steel of, as you said earlier, bending a paperclip, that constant pounding over a period. I was inspired to become an engineer by visiting the Fourth Road Bridge in 1964 as a child. That constant pounding of steel over that length of time, would that in itself not have led to a deterioration in the steel?
The construction of the Queensferry crossing is very timely. You know, the bridge is maybe not quite timely enough. Like people would argue as far that in the context of this particular failure, but the detailing that was around in suspension bridges in the 1960s were not, you know, the consequences of those detailings, that detailing is not as well understood as it is now. And so that the number of joints and the consequences of the vibration of those do create issues with the structure, none of which are in, I think, you know, the assessments have done today, that under the loading that it currently sees, the bridge is assessed to be capable of carrying the bridge-specific live loading that it carries at the moment. There are, you know, there will be a time limit on the capability of the bridge to take that loading. Things have been done to address that, to ensure that is mitigated with the installation of the dehumidification. The pounding of the joints, generally speaking, on the roadway, those are elements that are, there's thousands of those elements that see those cyclic loading. They require a regular inspection regime. They will see significant benefit from the moment that the Queensferry crossing opens.
And there will be a reduced loading at that moment when it opens.
Yeah. They won't see the heavy goods at all.
Right. Thank you.
An important point as well is with the historic maintenance that Feta began and has continued into Amey, everybody's rig familiar with the did it as you drive over the bridge. And I think that's the joints that you're talking about. We have an ongoing programme of works that goes on throughout the year to address the worst affected members, and that's informed by the inspections, where that's why there's overnight contraflows on the bridge and people don't often see people working there. It's because they're underneath, and we jack up the bridge at those localised points and put packing plates in to smooth out the bridge. And that's an ongoing programme of work that Feta began and indeed that Amey have taken forward.
And therefore, given the unexpected failure of this member, given the foregoing, you must, in terms of learning from this, have a view as to why then, I'm giving you a possible idea from the constant loading. Perhaps this was a less good piece of steel than all the other pieces of steel, but why did it therefore unexpectedly fail? Because that's what we need to know.
The actual detailing of the pin and where it's housed is, you know, there's the truss itself, and there's the pins that come up on the outside of the truss. So to be able to see the pin and whether it's moving or not and to inspect it, the actual moving pin should be moving within the link, but it's actually not the case. The links are fixed to the pin and those rotate it, and it moves relative to the truss box itself. So the actual moving part you can never see is the way in which it's detailed. So that in the replacement, that the reverse of that will happen. It will be put on the outside so that you can look at it. If there's a problem with it, you can take it out and put a new one in.
And just finally, so I'm right, if I understood you correctly, you said that the timescale for this essential fault, the crack to develop into a break, would have been around 6 months, and therefore this hasn't been a problem. I mean, the inspection regimes have worked, is really what I want to hear you say. But the failure was unexpected of this member for reasons yet to be defined.
I think that the reason, the failure of the member was because the pin has seized.
Right.
And probably has seized for a number of years.
I see.
And it's only because the steel has been so good that it's lasted this long.
Right.
Therefore,
finally, we have now inspected all the other pins at the relevant truss end links, and we believe, discovered that they are still functioning.
That is the strain. The stress monitoring is going on, becomes live as of yesterday evening, and so we're getting so that for the north end of the main span, we know that the one that broke was rigid, and the northwest side, which is free to move, and so that there is not the imperative to get the phase two repair on that immediately to allow the heavy goods back in. On the south side, we have no data to suggest it's not moving, but we will have confirmation of that from the strain monitoring in the next couple of days.
I'm intrigued by what you say, that the pin has not been functioning for a number of years. I'm catching up with what you're saying in its rotation and rotating mode to allowing it to work as a
The demand on a hot day and a cold, you know, so it will bend once in summer and once in winter type thing to deal with that, and that will be a yielding type bend that occurs if the pin is seized. And it will. You know, so that in the context of a very small strain, you know, you have to do a fair number of cycles before you break your paperclip. Mm-hmm. So that it will have seen a fair number.
My knowledge fails me, but would the expansion joints have actually protected the structure, in place?
Well, the expansion joints. The fact that the expansion joints are nice and rusty and maybe offering slightly more restraint to the structure than was originally intended would be helping. But one has to see this in the you know, I've worked on 20 suspension bridges. This is an immovable displacement. It's a hold it back. You're holding back. Mm-hmm. You're fighting the main cable, which is this round, mm-hmm. and you can't move that with a crowbar at the end of 5 meters of deck.
Yes. Right. Thank you very much.
Thank you, John. Claire, did you have a short supplementary?
Yes, please, because we were discussing the pin and when you were able to last see that the articulation of the pin was working. So, and you say it could have been seized for a number of years. What inspection process that was regularly carried out in the bridge could have identified that the pin was seized? And is it possible at all in the inspection regime to, you know, how do you know they're working basically?
I think that's, you know, that it has taken us quite a while to establish a system that reliably tells us that the pin is seized or has high friction, and that really has come down to being able to demonstrate that it never slips. And to do that, you have to have days of data to discover the event that would have caused the thing to rotate. Because it has to overcome the friction in the first place, so that for relatively, you know, if it's got a high level of friction in there, it won't slip until you overcome it. And so that you need to be there at that exact moment and be recording at that exact moment that slip has occurred, which is why you have to rely on structural health monitoring to actually determine that the thing is moving. Otherwise, you're inspecting at a 6 monthly basis to check there's not a crack.
So there was nothing in the inspection regime that would identify whether the pins are moving or not previous to this?
The visual inspection regime that was in place and is in place, and as Richard explained there, unless you were there at the precise moment that the pin rotated, you wouldn't observe that.
Thank you.
Did you have a brief supplementary, John?
Times would agreeable not have solved that problem and stopped it from happening.
There was one installed on the top end of this link, but in essence, the actual location of the inaccessibility of this location to be able to get a grease nipple onto it, it was virtually impossible to lubricate the bearing.
So, well, I've got nothing but respect for those who designed the fourth road bridge with only slide rules and log tables. Was that perhaps a design weakness, wasn't something to ensure the constant rotation of that bit?
The actual physical demand of displacement as well, that there's sort of two things have happened since those days. There's the understanding of the vibrations of buffeting of wind that generate cyclic movements of the deck that would not have been in those calculations at all in those days. There's the change in traffic loading and the weight of the vehicle, so that a single vehicle on the Humber Bridge, so I don't know the figures for Fourth Bridge, but a single vehicle on the Humber Bridge makes the whole deck move an inch one way as it gets to the quarter point, and it gets to the three-quarter point, it goes an inch back the other way. And that's a 40-ton vehicle, so that's directly proportional to the weight of individual vehicles causing that fretting of that pin that would have never been perceived at the time that the bridge was built.
Could I just take issue with you there? I cannot believe that wind loading wouldn't have been taken into
given
the failure of the Tacoma Narrow Bridge.
It's a different
bridge.
Sort of, so that there's the instability response of the Tacoma Narrows and sort of the wind tunnel testings that were done in those days, the understanding of turbulence in wind and the way in which that tunes to a structure rather than purely just being the structure itself creating the turbulence like on Tacoma Narrows, that wasn't understood in those days.
Thank you.
Q. Siobhan, did you...
Point question. Of clarification, Mr. Hornby. Obviously, we're talking about that one pin. And you said the way it had been designed, you couldn't see in it, but obviously the way that it's repaired, you will be able to see. Is that simply for that pin and the rest of the pins, you still won't be able to see?
My recommendation would be that all those linkages get replaced because the one has shown itself to be time-served. All of the others are ticking time bombs in to a greater or lesser extent. They should all be repaired. Having worked out what the actual the best solution is for that one location, one should implement it on all eight corners.
And to your knowledge, is that planned?
That is planned, yes.
Yeah.
Of course, we want this bridge to remain open for the foreseeable future and have a long, long life. So, yes. We will act on that advice. It seems a sensible and prudent thing to do, given what we know now.
And it can be installed in enclosures, so it's not that the actual works that involve you getting material to the underside of the deck can be done at night or at weekends.
And is that cost, because you talked about the phase one cost of £5 million, but you weren't quite sure of the next cost. Would that work be in those costs, or is that future work?
That will be additional costs, and we'll work up the design, we'll get costings, we'll put it up for consideration of ministers. I'm sure they'll see the merit in it, and we'll find a way to do this through our existing budgets. I'm sure. I hope to proceed with this spring summer. I think we shouldn't wait around for another incident.
When you have those costs as well, could you provide them to
sure.
the convener?
Yeah.
Okay, David.
Thank you, convener. Can I take the witnesses back to 2010, the FETA decision to initially go ahead with a proposal to replace the truss end linkages? Appreciate individuals here are not from FETA, and we will obviously get FETA to speak for themselves. The board clearly thought it was important to go ahead with this. They went to the point of advertising for consultants. Perhaps your best place, Mr. Lees, to advise us. Were the consultants ever appointed?
No. So I've done a lot of digging through the archives, and I've got a story, a timeline on that. not a story, a timeline.
Yeah, I'm reassured it's not a story. Yeah, facts would be what we want, yeah, today.
They're always the facts, yeah. So they put out a contract notice to make the industry aware. I have a copy of that here. That went out, let's just see. It's basically just describes the bridge and the likely work involved, and that was May 2010. So then, in the meantime, they're working up a interest in the job. There's lots of contractors and consultants coming back saying we're interested. So there's lots of records of acknowledgement of interest. Then around, I think it was September, there seems to be a change of heart, and I found an email from exchange between Mr. Colford and Colin Clark here, where there was a discussion about, are we sure this is the only way to do this? And it's clear that the decision or the conclusion was the scheme as it stood was unaffordable at the, I think there was a range of 10 to 15 million pounds put in. So then a dialogue developed where, yes, there is a no way of doing it, which then led into the scheme that's been delivered now. So once that decision had been made, FETIC put out a contract notice to cancel the works, their intention to do the design consultancy works, and all prospective tenderers were notified. And that's where it ends the trail, and the new scheme takes over. And in the FETA records, it's an ongoing issue for a number of years. There was there would appear to have been a lot of dialogue and exchange between the designers, which were Fairhurst, and the checkers, which took a good time to resolve. And that then led, once that dialogue was completed, that then led to the scheme that was trialled in May of last year, and then the subsequent works, which are ongoing now.
Is that not, I know you can't speak for FETA, and obviously they will speak for themselves, yes. I think, when they come before us. Is that not a strange way of doing things? You know, a board and professionals have a long discussion to say there's a need here to go and look at the trust side linkages, to appoint consultants, to actually advertise them, and suddenly, mysteriously, this gets cancelled. Can I ask, I don't know if you were in the same role in 2010.
No.
So it's difficult probably for you to answer for Transport Scotland. Can you give me your view on what Transport Scotland and Scottish Government's view on this was? And categorically, can you tell me if Transport Scotland and the Scottish Government advised, recommended and told FETA to cancel this contract to advertise the consultants?
One important factor to remember is that FETA were in charge of that bridge. We didn't get involved in decisions about programme or what schemes progressed. Our role was light touch governance when in terms of funding, that was our real role following the removal of tolls in 2008. Notwithstanding that, we were there to support them, and there's much evidence there. I can see the former bridge chief bridge engineer of Transport Scotland was regularly in contact and over across at the bridge to help the guys do peer reviews and the like. I must say that we had an excellent relationship with FETA and their staff, and considered them first rate. They were in a difficult situation. There was a lot going on in 2010. The cables were a problem. There was the anchorages. These were substantial projects. As John mentioned earlier, there was a bit of the, we've done a programme, this is our capital programme, we've approved it. It was a little bit of a wish list. And I've obtained evidence to show how that the FETA capital programme around then was basically prioritised by FETA. It's quite impressive what they did. There's a board paper of the 16th of December 2011 called Review of Capital Projects. They go on to obviously highlight that the comprehensive spending review has come back less than their proposed amount.
Come on and talk about that question later. Okay. I just want to know specifically about decision making. I appreciate you weren't in post then.
Yeah.
Who was your equivalent in 2010 when this decision was made?
We wouldn't have been involved in this decision. The equivalent would have been a chap called Graham Edmund, who was my previous head of the unit. But he wouldn't have been involved in any of this. This was a contract supposed to be let by FETA. Transport Scotland did not get involved in that kind of governance.
I understand that. I mean, but clearly, FETA, we understand the role that FETA had over the bridge, but clearly Scottish Government were 100% responsible for this. No one's suggesting the Scottish Government didn't have responsibility for the Forth crossing in 2010. But you weren't personally there.
We had a responsibility for funding. The governance and the maintenance, the operation and all the design work that had to be done and all that was FETA.
Sure. Okay. The point I'm making, and you might not have that information because I appreciate you weren't in post, I mean, did the Scottish Government reject in any format at a meeting by phone or by email to say that this project should not go ahead?
I haven't seen any evidence to that effect.
Right. Obviously, we'll ask the same question to FETA at a later stage. Obviously, this work didn't go ahead because the consultants weren't appointed. So, on one level, it's quite difficult to assess what would have happened if you'd appointed consultants and the work had been carried out. But presumably the terms of reference were quite clear. You've mentioned it was advertised. Mm-hmm. Has Transport Scotland analysed carefully the terms of reference of the 2010 proposed work on the Truss End Links?
We've obviously seen that. But in terms of further consideration, no. FETA decided to drop the scheme. Yeah. They come up with an alternative. That was passed over through the mobilisation period to Amey, and that was delivered. And I repeat the statement I made earlier about at no time through the mobilisation period was this ever the Truss End Links identified as a big issue.
Yes, and I totally understand that. I'm not looking for guilty people. I'm merely trying to get the timeline quite clear because there is... I mean, and clearly it's difficult for you to answer some of the points that I'm raising. So in terms of the terms of reference, Transport Scotland hasn't done a full analysis of that in terms of the 2010 terms of reference of the report that FETA wished to carry out.
No, that was a closed matter for FETA and their consultants, Fairhurst.
Right. So is it possible to do a compare and contrast with the work they were suggesting and the work that's currently being carried out?
Possibly, yes, if that would provide any merit, yes.
I mean, is it possible that you could do at least a basic attempt for this committee? Because that information is quite crucial, I think, in this inquiry.
We had a look at the proposed scheme at a distance, because as you can understand, during the last month and a half, we've had to basically assimilate a lot of information. The proposed scheme introduced many benefits, but also introduced many disbenefits. The key one being that the new connection was susceptible to vehicle strike. And I don't know how much that was considered. Colin can perhaps advise. But given that, we would have to put up an awful lot of barrier to protect the new linkages arrangement. But it was at an early stage. It was embryonic. I don't know, Colin, if you could confirm if there was anything really further to the 2009 workshop that laid out something, drawings,
no
approvals in principle.
Yeah, effectively, the 2009 workshop, we discussed the various options for actually taking the link in replacement forward. And there was nothing went beyond that. The job went to, was going to tender then.
Can I ask the obvious but important question, which I'm sure motorists in Fife and beyond and Hulls companies would want to ask? If the work was carried out in 2010, might we not have had a bridge closure in 2015?
We can hypothesise about this, but I have to put some caveats in there because I don't know what they were actually going to do. So the contract notice is fairly vague, right? There's a workshop report that gives a preliminary preferred solution. That doesn't say how the arrangement works. So if I assume that the new arrangement, which wasn't designed, was subsequently designed and it happened to be constructed and it made that member redundant, then yes, you can say that, of course, it's logical. The defect wouldn't have happened because it wouldn't have been there. It would have been redundant. But that's not where we are. Those decisions weren't made.
Sure. And I appreciate that you haven't done, as you very honestly said, a full analysis of this. But nevertheless, I'm sure the committee would appreciate some further comments on this. I appreciate time's going on, Camilla. Can I ask a couple of just quick further questions?
Mm-hmm. Just before you do that, David, Claire, did you have a supplementary on this specific point?
No, I came in after Dave.
That's fine. Thank you.
You mentioned, I think, the tolls came to an end in 2008. My understanding, talking to those who were involved with FET at the time, is that toll income was crucially important, mm-hmm. and that basically the toll income, by and large, went towards maintenance of the bridge. Mm-hmm. And in addition, FETA were able to borrow on the basis of proposed volumes of traffic, which is presumably fairly straightforward to predict. Was that a problem? I'm not making a case for and against tolls. That, mm-hmm. I think our votes are fairly clear on this. The point I'm making is, did that dislocate or affect badly the maintenance regime of the bridge? Because the steady source of income plus the money that was borrowed went straight into maintenance. Mm. Then there was a change, falling tolls coming to an end. What's your perspective on that, Mr. Lees?
From what I've seen, there was a steady income from the tolling, as I said, around £10.5 million a year. If you look at the funding levels from Scottish Government, we obviously made a commitment to fund them for toll removal. The funding does is not constant. It goes up and down in accordance with need and also how much money was available following UK spending reviews.
Sorry, this is not meant to be a trick question. Yeah. I'm just generally got in front of me.
But
do you know what the percentage, if you take what mm-hmm. you're spending on maintenance and what FETA spent, do you know what the proportions are?
Be roughly similar. I said in my opening statement that they're roughly the same year on year. If you average what we've provided, it's about, I think, £12.5 million a year. They were getting, on average, £10.5 million a year. But notwithstanding that, the bridge, given its age, may have required more urgent work, may have had more pressing needs. There might have been safety critical works, but we were always there to help if that was the case.
Well, the figures I have, and I'm happy to be corrected if you, the figures I have is that your capital grant was 13.8 million, is that correct, over a 3-year period? And that's only 58% of what FETA were spending. I mean, is there a different analysis you've got of maintenance need from FETA's days?
The 58% figure related to a capital programme for that 3-year period that FETA board approved. That was done in isolation of the spending review and any outcomes from the UK settlement. That obviously was difficult for FETA to deal with in terms of now they have to make a bid for cash, whereas in the past they had their own income stream. So I appreciate that that was a difficult issue for them. I found evidence of the submissions for the comprehensive spending review. Our approach is totally different. Their approach was, here's everything we want. And that was their programme, what they approved. We build up from the bottom. I've got a note of this. We highlight the minimum funding requirement for maintenance and the safe operation of the asset. And at the same time, you know, the work's required to maintain the structural integrity of the bridge. And then we look at the risks of not doing that work and the like. So, and that's something Barry and his team were very, very good at and did subsequently, because yes, we couldn't fund their full budget aspirations. John's advised that a bit of that was a wish list, but we covered the main priorities, and the team were able to manage the risk. And it, I refer you to their paper, Review of Capital Projects, 16th of December 2011, and you'll see that we covered the main ones, and they used risk analysis techniques to decide what other ones and the priority of those should be preceded.
Okay. The point I'm making is, was spending on maintenance higher during the FETA regime than it currently is now? My understanding is it was.
From the figures I have produced, it looks similar.
Right.
Although year-on-year variations.
So you don't recognise this 58% figure that I mentioned earlier?
No. I recognise it as a figure quoted in many of the FETA board papers, saying that Transport Scotland had awarded a budget settlement for capital works for a three-year period that's 50%, a 58% cut on what the capital programme for those 3 years that they had approved.
Yeah, I'll finish on that, Convener. Perhaps I would certainly welcome Mr Lee's sort of suggestion that he would provide some analysis of the terms of reference of the 2010 FETA report. That would be very useful, and to do some sort of compare and contrast of what they were suggesting the work was should be required and the work that's been carried out.
Thank you, David. Mr. Lees, if you were able to furnish the committee with the other information that you've made reference to in your evidence, that would be very helpful.
I've provided to the clerks a full pack of information, including my timeline, which would be very helpful in many of these issues.
Great.
But I would obviously provide anything that's required.
Okay. That's much appreciated. Can I just ask you then, in 2010, FETA had advertised for consultants to undertake a piece of work that would have replaced the truss end linkages. That's correct. And then in 2011, there's a decision taken not to proceed with that work. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay. And you indicated in your earlier evidence that there were no safety critical works that were not undertaken because of budgetary constraints. Am I right in that understanding?
Yes.
Okay. Can I ask you finally then, was it reasonable in your opinion, and I'm happy to allow the panel to answer this question as well, to give their view, was it reasonable for FETA to take that decision not to proceed with that work?
I believe so. I don't find anything wrong with the approach FETA took to manage their forward programme of work. They followed a risk-based approach, which is commonly used for asset management purposes.
Okay, can I ask the same question to each of the witnesses? Mr Clark, do you have a view?
Difficult question for me to answer, because as a consultant, we were one of several consultants working on the bridge, so I'm not party to all the information that FETA had at the time, so it's not
the question.
I don't feel I can answer that. Do you?
Right, Mr Hindshaw.
Convener, my view, having reviewed the evidence and the information in the evidence pack, is that this scheme appeared fourth or fifth in the list of priorities that FETA had. And I think, based on the evidence presented in the Fairhurst report and the workshop, and that it was tolerable and appropriate for them to look for a more cost-effective and less disruptive solution, on the basis that the solution from the workshop was clearly not fully developed, and any appointment of any consultant would have looked to have reviewed that and may well have, had it gone forward from the contract notice, not taken forward the workshop recommendation and come up with something different, which I find most likely, that the decision to take it forward on a slower programme, as was done by FETA, to be appropriate. It is interesting to note that
FETA never brought it to us as a safety critical piece of work that was urgently needed funding beyond the capital grant that we had given them at the time. And I feel that is germane to a lot of the arguments, because some years later, when additional funds were needed urgently to take forward the cable band bolts, we were more than willing to listen, or my predecessor was willing to listen and take that forward. And so it's an interesting concept. We have debated what would have happened if these works had been taken forward. We also need to consider what would have happened had FETA brought them to Transport Scotland and asked for additional money to do them, and had presented evidence that had persuaded us that, yes, they were urgent and they were needed doing. So thanks.
OK, John, I will bring you in once I've heard each of the panellists. Mr. Arndt.
Obviously, I can only factually comment on after June when Amey became involved, but based on what I've seen, and this is what I've seen, is that the assessment report identified these as not being overstressed. That was independently validated by another consultant. All of the inspection records to date indicate there to be no perceived problems at that area. So on the basis of that, the decision that FETA made would seem proportionate.
Okay, and Mr. Russell?
I think you'll find, as an ex-FETA employee and senior manager, I'm probably going to say FETA made the right decision based on the information that was provided by the report, which was that element was not overstressed. We took forward the work that was going on an overstressed element, which was the bracket, and that was agreed and put forward. So I think the decision was correct.
OK, thank you, Mr. Russell. And Mr. Hornby?
A potential outcome of the study could have been the recommendation. So we're slightly prejudging what that study would have come up with, so that the commission for the consultant might well have recommended that exactly the local strengthening that has been undertaken of the overstressed element would have been what they would have recommended at the end of that study, rather than the wholesale replacement of the link.
So my question was whether, given what the information that was available, was that decision that was taken by FETA a reasonable one?
I think I would agree with John Russell here that there was no evidence of distress in the elements of the link below, so that the localised strengthening that has been undertaken was proportionate.
Okay, thank you for that. John, did you want to come back in?
Well, given the consensus, but nonetheless, I'm particular for Fairhurst and Colin Clark. Well, the threats to the future structural integrity of the bridge as outlined, as identified in 2009 and 2010, my question was, why use those words, threat to the future structural integrity, if you don't mean them? And my question was going to have been, and probably still remains, do you believe that Transport Scotland engineers, or indeed the Scottish Government, understood the threat? Because when engineers tell you there's a threat to the future structure and integrity, I would have thought that bumps it up the priority list, call me old-fashioned. But, you know, and therefore, given that the risk analysis techniques that were, I don't mean to be horrid about, but you're all saying we're absolutely fine, but given that the bridge and the member failed, will there be a future re-evaluation of those risk analysis techniques, given that they didn't work?
Maybe if I just initially, I was talking about FETA's procedures.
Right.
FETA's bridge till last June. So it wasn't Scottish Government engineers that were looking at this proposal, it was FETA engineers. They decided on what proceeded or not.
Maybe Mr. Hornby would expand on your answer.
The evidence that was presented in 2010 was that there was overstress in particular elements, and a wholesale replacement was the answer. The scratching of head was done, say, okay, we have many other issues with this bridge, and the immediate structural integrity question that was posed by the Fairhurst and the independent checker was that these particular elements that are at the very top of that linkage are the ones that are suspect and need to be addressed. and those have been addressed. It has taken 5 years for those to be addressed, but they are on stream now, with completion anticipated in the next month or so. So that, on that evidence and without any signs of distress elsewhere, you wouldn't, if you were looking for things to do on that bridge, you wouldn't have started saying, I need to take out this thing in its entirety here, on the basis of the immediate risks that you are being threatened with. You know, the element that was identified as being at structural risk and caused, you know, the one that was said, okay, this is the structural problem that has safety implications, that has been repaired and strengthened.
And given your knowledge, would you accept that the Fairhurst assessment of the elements that need replaced was the correct one?
On the basis of no distress being observed elsewhere, that was the correct assessment at that time.
Thank you very much. Now, we were due to finish this session at 12 o'clock. Given the importance of this issue, in fact, I have another member who has some questions, I'm going to allow this session to overrun, and I'm keen that, Siobhan, you don't feel constrained by the time constraints, so please ask your questions as you would normally.
Thank you.
Over to you.
Thank you. Ms. Lees, at the start you mentioned the toll, 10.5 million, I think, is what you put it down to. And the figures from the FETA board for the grant funding following the tolls have shown that in 2007-08, both capital and revenue was £8 million. Could you explain that?
Just bear with me, I've misplaced the document with the funding levels. Here we are. Right, so we're talking 2008-09, was it?
No, 2007-08. So, again, the tolls would just have come to an end. So yep. What I'm trying to get to is, was there still revenue from the tolls coming in, or was it simply for that year there was £8 million paid in grant funding to FETA?
Right. I have got a document that summarises all the FETA accounts. So in 2008-09, there was no income from the tolls, but there was an...
It's 7-8, sorry.
7-8. Yeah. There was a toll income was 10.2 million in 2007-08.
So that 8 million then would be on top of the toll revenue, is that yeah. correct?
The 8 million for...
It was given from a grant funding paid to FETA in 2007-08.
Yes.
4.5 million was capital, 3.5 yeah. million revenue.
And that was probably for a scheme, probably that, what scheme would that have been, 8,000 or?
There was probably some, and still is some residue regarding the old 8,000, which is now the B800 upgrade and the M90 spur.
Okay.
FETA were involved in funding for that, because when the FETA order was introduced in 2002, there was scope for the money coming in from the tolls not just to go to the operation and maintenance of the bridge, but to also to go to some other projects that would alleviate congestion over the Forth, so including things like park and rides and road linkages either side, which that was one of them, so there was a fair bit of cost involved in that as well. And obviously with the tolls coming off in February, there was the residue of the rest of that financial year, so some of that money will be in there as well, which is sort of where you're going to.
Yeah.
It's to do with that as well. So there was an amount of money within that that had to keep staff paid, for example, on the revenue side, from the early February through till the end of the financial year. And similarly with the capital, there was residue of works that would have to be taken forward without being used from toll money, because that ceased to happen.
Okay. Well, that explained that. But in 2014-15 then, the capital money that's paid goes down to £1.7 million. Mm-hmm. Now, that seems a bit odd when the bridge is older, as we've all talked about. The traffic flow is continuing to increase. We've increased the tonnage in HGV that's going across the bridge, and yet the capital grant that has gone to FETA is £1.7 million. And it's been at a high of £8.7 million. So, what would be the reasons for that? I understand, obviously, the contract was taken over, in 2015, but what would be the reason for 2014-15 having such a drop in the capital funding?
I believe, and Wayne will correct me if I'm wrong, that there was reserves, and we FETA had capital reserves. Is that right, Wayne? And we asked them to use them instead of...
As you'll be aware, Ms. Nicholson... Nicholson, is it?
You can call me whatever, but it's McMahon. But
I'm sorry, my apologies. FETA had considerable capital reserves, and the intention was the bill meant that at the dissolution of FETA, FETA's assets and liabilities would pass to the Scottish ministers. So it was agreed that they would use some of their capital reserve to fund some of their projects and draw down on it in lieu of receiving a capital grant from us. Now, I haven't got the exact figures of what we gave them that year. The total grant revenue and capital in that year was 6.82 million, yeah. But the capital side of that was reduced so that they could draw on their reserves.
Okay, and that would be normal practice, I presume?
It was. The conditions of the grant letters, going back to the days when Transport Scotland provided the grant, was should FETA have not spent all the amount of money we gave them, they could carry that over, add it to their reserves, and that money could be used for the maintenance of the bridge.
Okay.
And for a number of years, FETA did carry considerable amounts of capital reserves, at one time running into the tens of millions, and then slowly over the last 7-8 years being drawn down. I think at the end of the period, when all the actuarial work has been done, the hand back at the moment to the Scottish ministers will be in the region of 3.2 to 3.4 million.
Okay.
So they still had reserves to take forward monies.
That's very helpful.
Forward works.
Thank you.
If you need specific details on the amounts of reserves, they're either in the pack that Scott Lees has given in the breakdown, or they can be provided.
That's very helpful. Thank you very much. I'm going back to the current programme of maintenance then, and for the upgrading work on the bridge. What's the budget for that year on year? And can it be fully funded by Transport Scotland?
We took over the FETA programme. That's been handed over to Amey. In terms of that, Mark, you can perhaps come in later and advise the scale of that and the schemes that we are doing. We've announced the budgets for the following year. They're reasonably healthy. So yes, we are confident that we can fund the needs of this bridge going forward, and we are committed to doing that. In terms of this year's budget, can you explain, Mark? Sorry, that the works that are ongoing.
This year's budget from 1st of April this year for the financial year is about 14.5 million for this year. What we've done is set out a prioritised list of schemes in order to address that budget. There's a balance between routine and cyclic maintenance and what was formerly FETA called capital projects. We obviously had, during mobilisation, the FETA 10-year investment plan, and we've taken cognizance of that. We obviously inform that with our own engineering decisions and things like the truss end links that come up that will feature in that programme. But some of the other capital works that we have ongoing or programmed for this year is motorisation of the existing gantry system that's there. That's the cradle that allows you to traverse along the bridge below it, and installation of a new gantry system. That'll very much speed up access, and as we've spoken about before, access to this component is very difficult. The gantries will aid that significantly. There's other capital works programmes associated with the suspended span underdeck access platforms, where the people that were out yesterday will have walked along the kind of mesh panel system. Those are obviously getting towards their life expiry date, so there's a scheme to replace them with a more modern system. It's very enjoyable, I'm sure. The sallow wire, which is a safety line that you can see in the photos there, that you walk along the bottom cord currently to get to the truss end links. It's 23, 24 years old. That's getting replaced right now on site. So that's one of the schemes we've taken for it. Not that it was unsafe, but all these things reach a life expiry and safety critical things are essential. There's a scheme to replace the South Anchorage storage facility that was demolished as part of the cable inspection works. And there's the ongoing routine cyclic maintenance, as I said before, to actually jack up these joints that over time become, or they drop down slightly to give you the repetitive did it effect. That ongoing happens throughout the year. So I couldn't narrow it down to four or five schemes because there's honestly the best part of 100 activities within that programme, but they are all assigned their own budgetary requirements and taken through the approvals process with Transport Scotland.
And we've spoken at length of how FETA came to prioritise things in the past, and uh-huh. we don't have to go back over that, but uh-huh. is that a similar process to you would use, or do you use an entirely different process?
I'm not sure the process FETA went through, in all honesty, but the process we do is we take account of what FETA produced in terms of their capital programme. We look at the basis of the defects on the bridge, need for access, improvements in technology and all the like. And on that, we make an informed decision and put that forward to Transport Scotland in the format of an annual programme that demonstrates how the money is allocated to each scheme and the programme for delivery. Now, some schemes obviously don't get delivered in a single year and take a couple of years to take forward. So there's, for example, maintenance painting on the bridge. That was one of the previous FETA schemes. It's one we're looking at, but you need to do it in a trialled manner and phased because, again, access and systems in the marine environments need trialled. So it's very much a proportionate response, but it is a regimented procedure we go through, very formal. That is submitted by dates dictated within our contract to Transport Scotland for approval and then subsequently taken forward.
And the projects that FETA had established in their capital plan, as they would call it, uh-huh. has that still been adopted, or is that simply we start from scratch?
We've honoured all of the ongoing contracts, and that leads me, I guess, back to the bracket strengthening work that was ongoing. That was the only project there was the gantry motorisation and the bracket strengthening work. Both were fully honoured and taken forward in that respect. And again, the guys at FETA and John and the team, like I said, 95% of those people are still there. So it's not that it's discarded by any manner of means, but it is a coordinated effort. And we set it out very succinctly in a structured manner how the budget is to be spent that year for approval.
I presume, and you can correct uh-huh. me if I'm wrong, because you know, that you wouldn't adopt everything, because no one would. You know, mm-hmm. you look at your own priorities, you see how that goes. But in your own plans for the year, regardless mm-hmm. of the unfortunate mm-hmm. position you were left in at the end of the year, mm-hmm. you would have looked at the trusts and seen what you could have done then. So was there a plan to do anything with those? What we've been through, what was happening with FETA, what they had decided, what they then went against. So we went through all of that, but was that in any which way on the plans of...
As I said before, we were taking forward the strengthening of the member that was identified as overstressed. That member that did fail wasn't overstressed, but I guess these things take time. We're still in the middle of getting this bracket strengthening work in place, and there might have been a review after, and things would have been looked at, but it wouldn't be appropriate for me to say just now whether they would or they wouldn't. Sure. That's the honest answer.
But they weren't, because you took over a contract, so when you're bidding for that contract and you're talking about works, when you get that contract and you've identified your priorities, that wasn't one of them.
No, I mean, you've got to remember that this is obviously a major suspension bridge. Sure. It would not be prudent to come in and discard all of the work or the prioritisation that's been done before by an experienced team. So you take the best of both worlds, you learn from that, and you bring any other engineering knowledge that you can to inform that. And that's the approach that's been taken.
Absolutely.
No further questions. Thank you. Do members have any further or final questions? Claire.
It's taken it back a wee bit, sorry, to the question that Mr. Stewart had. Mr. Lees, you were talking about the decision in December 2011 to review the capital projects. As my understanding, FETA undertook a risk analysis mm-hmm. based on a number of areas. Obviously with safety and structural integrity of the bridge at the heart of what they were deciding. In your opinion, was that risk analysis robust, and was there any independent accreditation of the process that they went through at that stage?
I do believe it's robust. I don't know the answer to the second part of the question, whether it was verified, but the rigour and the governance would have come from the FETA board. So the bridge master would have prepared a report on this, and he would have asked for a number of actions at the end of that report, and I assume at a board meeting they would have applied rigorous governance and then consented to that approach. But I go back to something I said before. I have high regard for the team that were at FETA. They knew what they were doing. They were good. And thankfully, the majority of those staff are still with us and are continuing to do a very good job in this difficult, significant incident we're dealing with.
Okay. Mr. Russell, were you involved in that process at all for the risk analysis?
Fortunately not, because I remember the guys taking it away and having to work on it several nights, and they weren't enjoying the process. Memory serves, you can check with Barry and Chris next week, but memory serves they did have independent people doing it as well. I couldn't say for it. My guess would be Atkins, but I can't remember exactly the detail on that, but I'm sure you can ask them next week. And it kept them awake for several nights over the weekend just going through the figures. But they came up with the right results in the end, and we managed to get a priority list and go forward with that.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. John, can it be brief, please?
To get my head round this completely, Mr. Hornby, I would like to ask you, so in your view, the thing that caused the failure of this member was essentially the seizure or seizing in place of the pin, the fact that it wasn't able to move freely, and that over time, perhaps a period of years, led to the failure of the member and the break in it.
Correct.
Thank you. And to be fair, it couldn't reasonably easily have been foreseen.
There was no mechanism to check that the pin was moving.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you, John, and thank you for that succinct answer, Mr. Hornby. Are there any further points that our witnesses would like to make and place on the record before we close? Okay. In that case, it only remains for me to thank you very much indeed for your attendance this morning, and I think I speak for all members when I say that we're very impressed with the quality of the evidence we've received. You've set a high standard for the rest of the inquiry. So thank you very much indeed. I'm now going to suspend the meeting briefly to allow the witnesses to leave the room. Thank you. We now resume this meeting of the Infrastructure and Capital Investment Committee. Agenda item 3 is subordinate legislation. The third item for today is the consideration of a negative instrument, Public Service Vehicles Registration of Local Services Scotland Amendment Regulations 2015, SSI 2015/420. Paper 5 summarises the purpose and prior consideration of this instrument. The committee will now consider any issues that it wishes to raise in reporting to the Parliament on this instrument. Members should note that no motions to annul have been received in relation to these instruments. I now invite comments from members. There are no comments from members. In that case, is the committee agreed that it does not wish to make any recommendation in relation to these instruments? We are agreed. Agenda item 4, also subordinate legislation. The committee will consider another negative instrument at agenda item 4, which is the Housing Scotland Act 2014, commencement number 5 and consequential provision order 2015, SSI 2015/430. Paper 6 summarises the purpose and prior consideration of this instrument. The committee will now consider any issues that it wishes to raise in reporting to the Parliament on this instrument. Members should note that no motions to annul have been received in relation to these instruments. I now invite comments from members. There are no comments from members. In that case, is the committee agreed that it does not wish to make any recommendation in relation to these instruments? We are agreed. In that case, I now move this meeting into private session.